Good morning, everybody. At the onset, I would like to thank the respected organizers of Seth Anandaram Jaipuria College for allowing me to present my small review work here. Myself, Anirban Mukherjee, will be talking on the topic, The Killer Instinct, a therapeutic insight into NK cell-mediated targeting of SARS-CoV-2. Now, let me run you down through a short timeline. On December 8, 2019, first patient developed symptoms like cough, fever, respiration problem due to an unknown virus. By the December, several other cases with the same symptoms were detected. Now, in about January 2020, the virus was detected and named to be SARS-CoV-2, and the disease was labeled as COVID-19. Now, fast forward to the later months of 2020, COVID-19 was declared as a pandemic. Now, well, the virus belongs to a well-reputed family, that is coronavirini and genus beta coronavirus. Their name coronavirus is justified due to the presence of crown of spike proteins on their surface. Particularly, this virus spreads by a respiratory droplet when an infected person openly coughs or sneezes. Non-infected person takes these up, virus moves through the trachea, then to the lungs, and then into the alveoli and attack the alveolar cells. Among the structural proteins present on the virus, that is the S, E, M, and N proteins, only the spike protein or the S protein can bind to the ACE2 receptor on the host cell and facilitate the release of RNA into the cell. Now, further replication and translation of the viral genome produces progeny virus, which are released by rupturing and destroying the cell. Now, looking at it from a physiological point of view, alveoli has two kinds of cell, that is 81 and 82. 82 produces surfactant and lowers the surface tension at an air-liquid interface, that is, helps in easy expansion of alveoli while breathing, which is depicted in the picture to the right. 82 attack more due to the presence of ACE2 receptor. Now, destruction of 82 lowers the surfactant level, causing high pressure in the alveoli, more likely to collapse and harder to inflate while breathing. That is depicted on the picture to the right. The picture in blue one. Immunologically, during the mild infection, inflammation occurs and virus is detected and removed. Patient starts to recover. But when the virus evades the immune system, damage levels increase owing due to inflammation, resulting in cytokine storm in addition with the virus-induced damage, which results in severe respiratory distress. Coming to the first line of viral defense, that is the NK cells, their actions are mediated by few receptors. Such as activating receptors like NKp44 and NKg2d, they kill the infected cells by releasing certain molecules like perforin and granzyme. They also have inhibitory receptors such as NKg2a. As antigen specificity is more or less absent in NK cells, these receptor is used to distinguish between a healthy and unhealthy cell. The NKg2a receptor specifically distinguishes a healthy cell by recognizing a MHC1 molecule or HLA-E of the healthy cell. Now, I would like to talk about SARS-CoV-2 modulating NK cell action. First of all, IL-6, IL-10 levels are high due to the cytokine storm, which upregulates NKG2A on NK cells. Moreover, infected cells present the spike protein peptide by HLA-E, which interacts with the NKG2A and inhibits NK cell action, as you can see the picture on the down left of the screen. As a conclusion, a significant strategy to tackle the virus in hyperactivated inflammatory COVID-19 patient may be possible if NK cells are activated. The CD94 NKG2A inhibitory receptor, which is also a C-type lectin receptor that can recognize carbohydrate moiety, can be a target for carbohydrate moieties of the virus, thereby preventing the interaction of HLA-E and the switching of the inhibitory NK cells, and which allows the NK cell to kill the infected host cells. Further study to investigate SARS-CoV-2 viral antigen that may bind to NKp44 receptor of NK cells. Cell might help to clear out the virus-infected cells. IL-6, IL-10 have been seen to increase the NKG2A receptor on NK cell in response to SARS-CoV-2 infection. Targeted inhibition of IL-6 and 10 may lower the inhibitory effects of NK cell. Thus, activating the NK cell stimulates TH1 cells expansion via induction of IL-12 by macrophage, that is, calling for the adaptive immunity, which has a higher antigenic specificity, clears of the virus from the host body, and the patient may start to recover. Now, these are the references I used to prepare this small review. And to sum it all up, thank you for paying attention to my presentation. And most importantly, stay home and stay safe.
First of all, I would like to give thanks to the organizer team for giving me a platform to present my small review work, myself, Kira Sharkar, and today I will be talking about COVID-19 and complement system modulation. So, let's begin. My first slide is about timeline of novel coronavirus. We know COVID-19 is a pneumonia-like disease that was first identified in Wuhan, China in December 31st, 2019. The disease is caused by a new coronavirus, SARS-CoV-2, and that is similar to the SARS virus. So you can see that there are several updates time to time, like it was in March 11 when WHO declared COVID-19 a pandemic with more than 1 lakh cases and 4,000 deaths in 114 countries. So moving on, here there is SARS-CoV-2 associated lung injury. Here, so we know that severe acute respiratory syndrome COVID is an RNA virus, and that causes the development of acute respiratory distress syndrome in the critically ill patients. That we can see in this picture. Our airway epithelial cells and vascular endothelial cells, they express certain kinds of ACE2 receptors, that is angiotensin converting enzyme 2 receptors on their surfaces, and they act as entry point for SARS-CoV-2. Now the virus, they enters within the cell, then uses the cellular machineries, make more copies of them and cause lysis of the cell. The SARS-CoV-2 virus, they can cause the activation of our complement system in three different pathways. Where the pattern recognition receptor, like the toll-like receptors, they drive the activation of lung resident macrophages. And the result is release of pro-inflammatory cytokines, interleukin-1, interleukin-6, interleukin-8, and interleukin-21, and so on. There is also extravasation of blood neutrophils, monocyte macrophages in the bronchi. And we can see that ultimately there is lung tissue damage, there is inflammation happening. In my next slide, there is complement system role in innate immunity. So there are three pathways. The first one, classical pathway, it is activated when the IgM or IgG antibodies Fc receptor binds to the complement component C1 complex. The second one, the lectin pathway, it is triggered by the binding of mannose binding lectin proteins with the spike proteins of SARS-CoV-2. And when these two pathways converges, there is cleavage of C4 and C2 proteins, formation of C3 convertage. The third one is alternative pathway. There is hydrolysis of C3 component, binding of factor B, initiation of C3 convertage formation. And then finally, the function of C3 convertage, it cleaves the C3 component in C3 and C3B, where C3A, it acts as anaphylatoxin, that is recruit the leukocytes to the site of infection. C3B, it gets deposited on cell surfaces, acts as opsonin, and it also takes part in formation of C5 convertage. Now C5 convertage function is, it cleaves the C5 component in C5A and C5B. C5A, it acts as anaphylatoxin. C5B, takes part in the formation of the membrane attack complex with other complement proteins, and it causes the cell lysis of the pathogens like the viruses. And moving on, and this is my last slide. Here I want to conclude that complement system plays a critical role in the host innate immune response, in virus clearance and activation of adaptive immune system. But when it gets unstrained, then only it can cause the acute chronic inflammation. So there is maladaptive immune response, excessive innate immune system pathways going on. And so, there is pathogenesis of COVID-19. And here I'd like to add that the inhibition of complement in the first week of infection is problematic, as at this time, it works in favor of our body, that is, it gives protection from virus. But in the second or third week of infection, the complement inhibition becomes crucial, because that time it's damaging our cells. So researches are going on, and the drugs that can be used in this process are eculizumab and ravulizumab. These are anti-C5 monoclonal antibodies, mainly to inhibit the complement response to COVID. And the ravulizumab is recently safety is evaluated. And the references are given in below here. And thank you for paying your attention.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. At the onset, I would like to thank the respected organizers of this webinar to allow me to present my small review work out here. Myself, Abhigyan Dattu, will be talking on NATOSIS, can it be used against SARS-CoV-2? At first, I would like to give some little information on the COVID-19. The coronavirus disease or COVID-19 is an infectious disease caused by the newly discovered coronavirus. The COVID-19 virus spreads primarily through the droplets of saliva discharged from the nose when an infected person coughs or sneezes. The COVID-19 has been shown to bind with ACE2, the angiotensin-converting enzyme 2 receptors of the lung cells mainly, via the S protein on its surface. The COVID-19 infect the alveolar type 2 cells and lead to the apoptotic lysis of these cells. Now, the basic symptoms involve fever, dry cough, loss of taste or smell, difficulty breathing, or shortness of breath. Now, what is NATOSIS? As per the name, you can easily understand that it is a unique form of cell death characterized by the release of decondensed chromatin on the granular contents into the extracellular space. Now, when we are talking about COVID, we are talking about basically the two types of NATOSIS. We are talking about viral or vital NATOSIS. That is, the in this case of this NATOSIS, only the nuclear element gets decondensed, but the maximum cytosolic element remain unaffected. Now, in this picture, you can see that the enucleated neutrophil continues to phagocytosis of the microbes, whereas in case of the suicidal NATOSIS, both the nuclear and the cytosolic element get decondensed and released via the NAT formation. Now, in this picture, you can see that there's a beta-glucan receptor and the LPS and the TLR4 receptor, that is a pattern recognition receptor. From this, the NAT can be generated. And the next slide, that is the cascade events of the neutrophil extracellular tract formation, that is when neutrophil with its triggering ligand, that is the cytokines and chemokines, it is generated, the calcium influx and the ROS is being generated. ROS is a reactive oxygen species. This leads to the activation of the PAD4 enzyme. This PAD4 enzyme is a peptidyl arginine deaminase 4. This enzyme leads to the conversion of arginine to citrulline, which is a process called citrullination. When the arginine is a positive charge amino acid and the citrulline is a neutral charge amino acid, this conversion is gradually leads to the nucleosomal decondensation, and the decondensation of chromatin is occurred. You can see here the human nuclear protein is been decondensed and formed the NAT. And in this picture, there are three major inducing pathways are present here. The first one is the FMLP, that is the mTOR-dependent autophagy pathway. This pathway, via the action, that is the ROS generation and the direct degranulation, the NAT can be released. And these two pathways, the LPS and the CXCL, which is a major important chemokine of our immune system that could activate the PAD4 enzyme. This PAD4 enzyme activation further leads to the decondensation of chromatin and the NAT can be released. Now, today's main topic, can NATOSIS or NAT formation prevent COVID-19? Now, though NAT can action against viruses via TLRs and activate its PDCs, that is the plasmacytoid dendritic cells, which in turn release high amounts of type 1 interferon. Now, we all know that the type 1 interferon is a major macrobicidal or antiviral product. Now, the NAT could increase the antiviral adaptive immunity by reducing the activation of the threshold of the T lymphocyte. When the T lymphocyte activation threshold is reduced, then the T lymphocytes are easily get activated. There are induced platelet activation and IL-8 also have an important role in the NAT formation. So the NAT also have macrobicidal and the antiviral products like neutrophil elastase, myeloperoxidase, that is the MPO, and the defensin. These compounds also clear the major portion of the viral load. Now, the main point, the viruses can evade the NATs via IL-10 activation of the host or via viral IL-10 homolog by using the L1 of glycoprotein to activate disease cells. Now, these disease cells, the dendritic cells, other than the plasmacytoid dendritic cells here, they release the IL-10, which viruses use to evade the NAT or the neutrophil extracellular trap. Now, in this case, the SARS-CoV-2 interactions with the NAT is still not uncovered totally. Research is still going on. So the topic is still not cleared, but there is a chance that it can definitely remove a major portion of it. I am talking about the viral load, and thus acting as a major player of the immune response against the SARS-CoV-2 associated immune modulation. Now, I have come to the end of my presentation. This slide and this picture is basically an electron microscopy picture of the E. coli P4 phage toxin induced NAT formation by the bovine neutrophils and staining done by the Sortex Orange DNA staining. And you can see here, this mesh-like structure is called the neutrophil extracellular trap. And these are the neutrophils formed. The neutrophil extracellular traps are formed. And these yellow-colored structures are the E. coli P4 phage, which are the toxins are being caught up by the NAT. And these are the bibliography and references. I took maximum of the pictures from the NATOSIS, Immunity, Pathogenesis, and Therapeutics by Geeta Rai from this book. And these are the references. And last of all, thank you. And that's all.